What's up, everybody?
Should I put it sideways or should I leave it as is?
No, you good. All right, guys. This is episode 7 of Hoops Talk with Dave's Joint. Check out our YouTube page, our Instagram page for all the other videos. But without further ado, we welcome Mr. Corey Underwood, trainer and former professional basketball player. Corey, thanks for coming on to talk to me.
Appreciate it, Dave, man. You know, happy just to be here, and thank you for the opportunity, you know, to speak and, you know, just rap.
Mm-hmm. Indeed. So my first question is, what motivates you to be successful in the game of basketball?
As a player or as, you know, like currently?
Both.
Well, as a player, it was just a competitive spirit. I wanted to be great. I loved the game. To this day, you know, I still study the game as far as just watching players and you know, watching a lot of film. And basketball is my life. So it kind of naturally just, like, you know, transitioned over to, you know, training, coaching, the same attitude to where, you know, it's just a competitive thing where, you know, I want to find the next best kid or take a kid that nobody knows and bring him into limelight, you know, that kind of thing. So it's just it's a competitive thing. It's a competitive thing.
Indeed.
And I enjoy it.
So when did the game first become a part of your life?
I started playing, not seriously, but, you know, just recreationally, like when I was 4 years old.
You said four?
Yeah, four. I kind of was like following a guy from my neighborhood named Snap, Darnell Childs. And I used to always like follow him to the park. That's when I learned how to dribble. And, you know, that was like my first introduction into basketball. I probably didn't start playing like organized basketball till I was about 9 years old, 9, 10 years old.
Nice. So what part of Queens are you from?
I'm from East Elmhurst. It's on the west side of the Queens, right by LaGuardia Airport. Literally could walk to LaGuardia from my old house. So I'm from East Elmhurst, Queens.
Talk about, you know, the basketball culture in the borough of Queens.
It's big. It's big, you know. For whatever reason, it's not mentioned a lot, but especially on my side of Queens, you know, it's kind of split up into like East and West. I'm like on the West side, the neighborhoods of like East Elmhurst, Corona, you know, Derek Phelps is from my neighborhood, Corona, you know, where Left Rack is, Kenny Anderson, you know, Kenny Smith, those guys. You got Long Island City, the projects, Ravenswood, Astoria, Queensbridge, where Ron Artest is from. It's a lot of talent on this side. It's a lot of talent. You know, people don't really, I don't want to say people don't think about it or give it its just due, but it should be, you know, I think, you know, mentioned a lot more than it is.
Awesome. So where was that one place that you liked to play when you were younger? Like one, just give me like one tournament or one facility.
I really liked, well, coming up, I love Citywide. I love playing in Citywide. I used to, it was like in Queens, right by the mall, Queens Center Mall, in a park called Hoffman. So, like, I love playing Citywide. I did it for 2 or 3 years. Played with BQ Express, Artie Cox. So, like, that was, like, one of my favorite places to play at.
How was the talent at ISA back when you were playing?
Oh, man. ISA was amazing. I loved ISA, and I'm glad you mentioned that because I wasn't even thinking. I'm thinking, like, you know, when I was, like, grade school and young. But ISA, I would say, was my number one place for sure. Friday night game, 8 o'clock, nothing beats it, you know? Nothing beats it. I know it's still there, but, you know, back when I played, that was, like, a big deal. Championship Sunday, you know, standing room only. It's still the same now, you know, but – you know, when ISA was going on back then, like in the late 90s, early 2000s, it was really special.
Now, talk about playing for Riverside Church.
It was brief. I mean, you know, like I was a part of BQ Express, which was Artie Cox, was like I guess you would say, like, the Queens version on, like, the feeder program. You know, Audie had a lot of the Queens and Brooklyn kids. And, you know, if you played with Audie and, you know, you did well, or I guess, you know, he was, you know, a kind of, I guess, like a known guy, he would, you know, go on trips to Riverside. You know, you would play Riverside on trips. I played briefly with Riverside my junior year. My senior year, I didn't play, you know, in high school. So I played with the Riverside college team. So, you know, that was my experience with Riverside. But it was mostly BQ Express, mostly.
You also played for the Panthers. You know, talk about those days.
Oh, well, you know, that came from Speedy Claxton. Speedy Claxton was from my neighborhood. Mm-hmm. Speedy, you know, played CYO at St. Gabe's. Was like, it's like 2-3 years older than me. You know, kind of like a big brother. And anything Speedy did, honestly, I kind of like looked at it and followed suit. So, you know, when Speedy left St. Gabe's, went to Christy King, and he started playing AAU. You know, he started with Audie, and then he moved on to the Panthers. So that's how I started playing with the Panthers with Gary. Mm-hmm.
So high school, you first started out at McClancy, am I right?
No, I started out at Bishop Lachlan.
Oh, wow. All right.
Yeah, I went to Bishop Lachlan.
How long were you at Lachlan for?
1 year. So, you know, I went to Lachlan. I just was in love with Bishop Lachlan. I had really no idea anything about the school except like one of my close friends from the neighborhood went there, and he was playing freshman. And I just wanted to go to Lachlan because I just thought it was going to be, like, this amazing. It is. It's, I love the school. It just wasn't for me as far as, you know, I didn't know too much about, you know, put it like this, getting recruited to a school or, you know, I wasn't in the plans. Like, these guys didn't know. I just showed up. And when I got there, you know, it was some really, really good players, like Brian Brown, Cliff Strong, Will Dudley, Raymond Daly. These are like guys that, you know, was all in my class. And it was stacked, you know. So I went there and I kind of was taken back and had no idea. You know, and at this time, I'm ninth grade. I'm like 5'10", 5'11", mm-hmm. you know. So, you know, it was a little different from me. Like I wasn't the greatest coming up. You know, a great game for me was like scoring 10 points in CYO. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I'm proud to say I'm a late bloomer. I was a guy, you know. It came together for me when I had my growth spurt, you know? So, but I was at Lachlan my first year. I was at Lachlan. I didn't play. I made the team. I was probably like the 13th, 14th guy on the team. And I just made a decision, you know, myself to say, you know, this is probably not the place for me. You know, it's stacked. And I didn't know I was going to grow, you know, 7-8 inches over the summer. But I just felt like I was going to go to McClancy. And, you know, the odds were probably better for me there. It was not too far from my house. And, you know, I was going to, you know, turn McClancy around. That was my thinking pattern.
So you had to sit out that first year at McClancy?
No, I didn't, because I didn't play at Lachlan. So literally.
Oh, okay. So
I didn't play.
So you got to play for 2 years at McClancy, correct?
I played a year and a half. JV, okay. I quit in literally a year. You know, I had a little issue with the coach and, you know, just being young and silly. I didn't, you know, I didn't stick it out. I got in trouble. I skipped practice one day, was outside hanging out with some girls. Mm-hmm. And he caught me. I got suspended for a few games. And when I came back, I just wasn't playing, like, you know, playing a lot. Just felt like the guy had me on a leash, you know, just young and silly and, you know, not knowing what you know now, you know. And I just said to myself, like, you know what, I'm gonna quit. And I quit. So I finished like probably 75% of the season. I just didn't play like, you know, February and March.
Right. But the later months, that would have probably helped them.
Right, right.
So your junior year, you averaged 14 points and 11 rebounds for McClancy. You know, talk about that season.
Very, 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 it was an interesting year. Again, you know, as a kid, I was a knucklehead, not like a thug or a fighter kind of kid. You know, just, you do silly things. I'm in class making noises, you know, laughing, making, you know, making jokes and always getting in trouble, and I'm in detention a lot. And that year, it's funny, it started out, you know, I was suspended all like throughout the like the scrimmage season. We had a bunch of scrimmages set up. I couldn't practice. I couldn't scrimmage. And, you know, my first time like playing varsity was my first game. We played against Van Buren, I want to say. I had like 7 points. I had the game-winning shot to win the game. But, you know, my junior year was interesting because Coach Kent, great guy, love him. He was known for not playing juniors. Like he would play his seniors, and you know, which I respect because he wanted to get kids into school, and you know, but you know, I really fought hard, and he tried not to play me. But after the first game, you know, I was kind of successful. I started a couple of games after the first game, and I remember I hit a little bump. I kind of you know got a little big headed. Put me back on the bench again, and then maybe like 4 or 5 games later, we had like I had a big game against Bishop Ford. And, you know, he started, I started like for the rest of the season after that.
So what led to you ultimately leaving McClancy?
I was kicked out, honestly. I was kicked out. So
what did you do?
Again, like I said, it was a thing where, you know, I wasn't like a fighter, you know, like – you know, the kids at McClancy are cool. Like, I had no issues with them. I was just like a class clown, you know? Mm-hmm. And I guess after a while, they just got tired of it. And honestly, you know, to be honest, it wasn't to me personally, it wasn't an issue where I think I deserved to be, you know, dismissed. I just think, you know, it was just like, you know, let's just get rid of them. And, you know, silly stuff, you know, making noises in class, you know, telling jokes. But, you know, I wasn't like a guy coming and beating up students and stuff like that. It wasn't the case. But, you know, they sent me a letter and, you know, telling me it was probably best that I don't come back.
Wow.
I didn't want to go back, to be honest with you. I kind of had my eyes set on going to Forest Hills with a couple of my friends. Mm-hmm. And so I was kind of already, like, you know, exploring that to see how that would go.
Mm-hmm. In the paper, in the Daily News, they said that you left. But obviously, you know, they're not – these Catholic schools will never tell the real story behind everything.
I was dismissed. I mean, well, put it like this. They sent me a letter saying it was probably in my best interest.
Corey, can you hear me?
I got you. I can hear you. Can you hear me?
All right, so, yeah, continue the story.
So, yeah, like I said, you know, it was a thing where I think it needed to happen. I grew from it. You know, I was very – you know, I was big-headed. Big-headed guy at the time. You know, very – you know, I want to say loud and obnoxious kind of thing, but more of a thing where, you know, just I thought I was the shit. You know, excuse my language, and it knocked me off. It humbled me, you know, because it really hurt my recruiting. I was starting.
Hold on, Corey. Hold on.
Okay.
Yeah, continue.
So yeah, like I was saying, you know, it hurt me a lot, but it was a lesson that needed to be learned. Yeah, you know, at that time, I think I was starting to get like Big East interest, Linux 10 interest, and a lot of these schools didn't know. You know, I got kicked out of school until like it was like around June. It was coming at the time. It was a tournament that a lot of the high schools would go to called the Metro Classic at Fairleigh Dickinson.
Yeah, and very common tournament.
Yeah, so you know, like a lot of the schools in the area would go and play. And like I remember, like one of my friends was like, "Yo, bro, like you know, Coach Kent told us, you know, Notre Dame was looking for you, and you know, he told me, you know, he doesn't go to school anymore." And, you know, I think once the word got out that I was, like, you know, dismissed from McClancy, it changed the recruiting for me, like, a lot, drastically.
Wow. So, basically, he kind of tried to shut doors down for you, like, kind of blacklist you in a way.
Well, I wouldn't say it was Coach Kent because he really, you know, he tried his best to fight for me. the issue I had and like my family had was with like, you know, the administration there, which was like the dean, the
so it was higher up. Basically, he did all he could do for you, and then, you know, he had to abide by what the school had to say.
Right. Like, look, I think he fought as much as he can without, you know, jeopardizing his own job. But I think he fought as much as he could, you know. But my issue was always with, like, the dean and students, and it was, like, the system. You know, like, anytime something happened in the school, and I never really spoke about this before, anytime something happened in the school, it was like, let's go find Corey. It's probably his fault, you know. And it was just – it was tough because, you know, like, a lot of times I remember, like, I would go to school and say to myself, like, listen, you know, shut up, I'm not going to say anything. I'm tired of getting in trouble. And, you know, it just somehow, some way, you know, if anything happened, you know, whatever, it was just like, it was my fault. And it was rough. It was rough. Yeah. I'll never forget one day I was in class. It was eighth period and I had math. And we were like, you know, like sitting in class and you know, the chairs assigned like, you know, row seating, like single row seating. And the teacher was a brother. He was walking up and down the aisles checking homework. And one of these kids spit on the floor, right? Literally, he's walking up and down the aisle. He sees the spit on the floor.
And he points the finger at you.
No, not even that. Like, the kid just looked down, and I looked down, and I looked up at him. And it was the other kid. It wasn't me, you know? And, like, he just looked at me and said, get up and get out and, you know, go get a detention slip. And I'm like, wow. I looked at the kid. I'm like, bro, you got to say something. You know I'm getting in trouble every day, you know, and, you know, you got to, yo, just tell the truth, bro. It's not. And, you know, he looked at me and he was just like, you know, shrugging his shoulders. And I'm like, yo, I didn't do this.
Set you up, basically.
Yeah, it was crazy, man. Like, you know, and I didn't tell him the kid. I just, you know, I took it. You know, I went downstairs. I said, he thinks I spit on the floor. It wasn't me, though. I didn't spit on the floor. I said, why would I do that? And another thing at the school, every time I got in trouble, Dave, it was always they took basketball away. Like, this is the kind of things I was getting in trouble for. I come to school. Like, I don't know the rules. I'm part to blame. You know, there was no parts. I couldn't get a part. Like, you know, I would get, like, the Steph Marbury part in the middle of my head, right?
Mm-hmm.
You see, oh, you know, you can't do that. You know, like, I got to give you detention. You know, I got like 3 weeks of detention for, like, having a little part in the middle of my head. You know, I do something like that, like, the day of a game or day before a game. It was just crazy, man. So, like, I just got tired of it. It was, like, really, like, you know, draining emotionally. And like, that's what I said. Like, towards the middle, end of the school year, I knew I just didn't want to be there anymore. So when they kicked me out, they kind of helped me out because I probably would have went back. My family probably wouldn't have let me left. But when they kicked me out, it helped me, you know, to move to somewhere else where I wanted to be.
Now, talk about Forest Hills. Like, what happened to your – what happened in your senior year that, you know, ultimately led to you not being able to play?
Oof. So going into the McClancy thing, you know, the rule back then was if you were dismissed from a school for disciplinary reasons and you transferred, you had to sit out. So, you know, a lot of people didn't know, you know, like, and we was trying to paint the picture that, you know, I left because of financial issues. It wasn't really the case because actually at that time, Riverside was paying my tuition. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I went there and, you know, I knew the coach, good guy, met him a few times, you know, this is myself. Like, and, you know, told him I wanted to come, and, you know, Jai Bay was a really good friend of mine. Well, still is, you know, and I wanted to play with Jai, and, you know, we thought this would be a great move, and, you know, he got the waiver, and, you know, he put in that, you know, I was, you know, leaving the school because of financial hardship.
Right.
Couldn't afford to pay the tuition anymore. And literally, you know, he had to send it to McClancy, and the athletic director at McClancy, I won't say his name, but, you know, he's gone. He passed away. But, you know, he got the waiver, and instead of just saying, you know what, I don't want to hurt the kid. I don't, you know, I want to see him win. You know, I want to see him do well, get a scholarship. He literally, you know, sent it back saying I was dismissed. And I remember the coach at Forest Hills, he called those guys, said, listen, you know, you kicked them out, you did what you know. You guys used them all year, you let them play. You know, then at the end of the year, knowing that he wouldn't be able to play anywhere else next year, you kick him out. Like, listen, let's just bury this. sign the waiver, let the kid play. You know, he's gone. Like, there's no reason to still try to hurt the kid. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they didn't do it. And I know you, like, because, you know, you're heavy into the artifacts with the newspaper. Mm-hmm. You know, he forged the coach of Forest Hills. I won't say his name. Great guy. I love him. He forged the waiver. And, you know, when they sent it back, and he changed it to, you know, financial hardship. So I played a couple of games. I mean, we were stacked. You know, we our front line, and this was probably unheard of at that time, unless you was like at like an Oak Hill or, you know, like a national power school like Rice, St. Pat's, or something like that. You know, our front line was me. I was 6'7" at the time. Jaja was about 6'7". And then we had a kid named DeJuan Gary, went to LIU. He was about 6'7". So, like, across the – you know, we were 6'7", 6'7", 6'7". The backcourt was Darryl Pell from Left Rack. God bless him. He passed away, you know, a couple of years after high school. He was about 6 feet, and then our point guard was, like, maybe 5'10". Kid named Max. You know, so, you know, we was pretty, like, you know, intimidating. Like, you know, you just see us coming out. Like, I played about – 2 or 3 scrimmages. I mean, we probably beat guys by like 50 easily. Like, you know, we were going into, you know, you scrimmage 6 quarters. We were killing guys. And literally after like on my last scrimmage, it was like a Thursday or Friday, coach came in and told me, he was like, listen, I don't know who, you know, somebody, you know, just, they won't let this thing die. And they're reopening it up, you know, your case. And, you know, you can't play until I find out what was going on. And then, like, a couple of days later, he was like, you know, they found out that, you know, the waiver wasn't, you know, was tampered with and you're ineligible. And I'm like, oh, man. And I chose to stay at Forest Hills. Like, I had opportunities to go elsewhere, like go to prep schools or go across the water in Jersey to play other schools, Marist. And I don't know, you know, for whatever reason, I just chose to stay at Forest Hills. Mm-hmm. You know, kind of like almost like, you know, you made this bed lie. And I stayed, I went to class. You know, I couldn't even work out with the team because it was just like such a bad thing. Like, I was at first, and then, like, it was just, you know, so much going on with the way that, you know, I was, you know, they caught me with the waiver thing. It was just like, you know, coach was just like, you know, just for the sake of all of this, let's just kind of like, you know, don't want you at practice. I don't want any more extra heat, you know, because he was getting a lot of heat for tampering with the waiver. And, you know, and like, again, I love that guy. He was Coach Eisen, you know, because he didn't have to do that. And, you know, he really tried to help me, and, you know, he got himself in trouble. Actually lost his athletic director job.
Wow.
Yeah. It was in the papers.
Yeah, I might have to look that up. But, yeah. So, I mean, you stayed and you graduated.
Yep, State graduated. You know, team went to the Garden that year. They lost to Grady, maybe like by like 7-9 points. You know, we was like the hands-on favorite to win the city with me playing. I think we would have definitely won the city easily with me playing. The state, matter of fact, you know. But, you know, without me, it was, you know, we had a really good team. Like, those guys, they went all the way. I think maybe they might have lost like that season, maybe like 3-4 games the most. But, you know, they made it to the Garden, which was huge. So, you know, it was a huge accomplishment.
How did it feel not being able to play in that championship game?
Oh, and, you know, I went, too. I actually went, and I sat there and watched it.
Mm-hmm.
It was tough. That time, Grady had Carl Sanders, and they had a kid, I think I want to say his name was maybe Raheem Jones or something, like 6'6 kid, and he killed us. And it hurt me because I knew I could really have, you know, helped the team and really would have, you know, left my mark. And, you know, it was tough because I was starting, like I said, like, you know, from McClancy, you know, 14-11 in the Cavalry at that time, you know, every night we were playing against high major guys, you know, whether, you know, it was Lachlan, Rice, St. Ray, you know, you were going against guys that were going to, you know, Power 5 conferences. And 14-11 in the Cavalry was almost like, you could say it's like 25 and like, you know, like 25 and 10, 25, 15 rebounds in the public league at the time. Like, public school, don't get me wrong, I wasn't saying it was, you know, easier, but the talent was a little bit more spread out versus, you know, Brooklyn, Queens and the Catholic League and, you know, and, you know, Manhattan and the Bronx and, you know, Capital League. It was a little bit spread out. So, you know, I thought that we, or I personally, I was going to be like the all city caliber kind of guy. And, you know, it was just going to be a whole lot easier versus, you know, the Capital League.
Yeah. So where did you go after Forest Hills? Before the St. Francis story.
Okay, so after Forest Hills, I had an opportunity to go to a couple. Well, I had my preferences was I wanted to go to the Hofstra, right? Mm-hmm. And Jay Wright, you know, knew me from Speedy, and I just literally told a story the other night. Good friend of mine's family friend, like my brother, Antoine Dobie. He's at a prep school this time, and he's telling me, "Yo, come to Philly. We play in Sunny Hill, and you know, we play against Rasul Butler." And like everybody was talking about, you know, like, "Yo, you versus Rasul Butler will be like a crazy matchup." And like, you know, I'm like, "Oh, we're playing against Rasul, you know," and I'm coming. You know, also God bless the dead. You know, Rasul passed away like recently. You know, I get on the train. You know, get down to Trenton. They pick me up in Trenton. We drive to Philly. And, you know, the game was like 8, 9 o'clock. I played against Rasul. We went at it, you know, jumped back on the train, you know, the Amtrak, then also the city train. I get home at 3 in the morning. At that time, that day, it was funny because I was supposed to meet Jay Wright. I opted to go to the game. So the next day, I don't go to school. I take the LIRR out to Long Island, and, you know, I go up to the office and, you know, to meet with Jay Wright.
This is when while you're in high school.
It's my senior high school. He's like, you know, "What was you at yesterday?" I was like, and, you know, I don't remember what I told him, but, you know, he knew. It was crazy. You know, I had no idea. Like, you know, people were, like, really, like, following me and tracking me like this at the time. You know, I'm still thinking little old me. And he was like, "You're supposed to be here, but you was in Philly playing in Sunny Hill."
Damn.
And he was like, "Corey, you don't have to do this kind of shit no more. You know, like, people know who you are. You know, you should have been here. You know, we wanted to meet with you and so on and so forth." And I just sat there. I was just kind of shocked. And, you know, he had a plan for me. He wanted me to go to Nassau Community College for a year and then transfer into Hofstra, sit out, and then play. And I was just totally against it. I was like, "There's no way." And it was silly, honestly, because, you know, eventually, like, you know, I went to St. Francis. I sat out at St. Francis. So it pretty much was the same thing. Well, not really the same thing, but, you know, it was very simple. And the second option was, at the time, Iona head coach was Tim Welch. He had just took a job at Providence. And, you know, again, like, I'm playing with the Panthers, with Gary Charles. And I remember Steve DeMayo, who's at St. John's now, he told Gary that, you know, he wanted me to go to a prep school. It was Chester Academy for a year, and they was going to take me. So pretty much it was like a stash and sign. And I was just, at that point, I was just totally tired of high school. I wanted to get out. I wanted to go to college. And, you know, Gary was trying to, like, you know, "Yo, see, you got to do this, man. Why wouldn't you want to go to prep school for you?" You know, at this time it was kind of popular. Everybody was doing it. And I was just so tired of the process, you know, from my junior year at McClancy, you know, what I went through at Forest Hills that year. I just wanted to go to college, you know. And I was like, "Nah, Gee, you know, I just think I'm gonna go to St. Francis." And, you know, it was silly. You know, it could probably help me, you know, in the long run. You know, you think about my short career, you know, in the NBA, that could have turned in, you know, from maybe a 3-4 month period, you know, to a, you know, a 4-5-6 year NBA career. Like, if I went to Providence and played well, you know, you never know. But I'm just saying, like, you know, it was silly, you know, but I just chose to go to St. Francis.
Now, unfortunately, you didn't get to play at St. Francis.
So... Oh, I played one year.
Oh, okay. That time with Coach Ganlin.
Coach Ganlin is a very interesting man. I mean, it was funny. I actually seen him about 2 years ago up at Connecticut at the prep championships up in Connecticut.
Right.
You know, he's seen me. He's still the same guy, man. You know, I seen him. I'm like, Coach, I gave him a hug. He kind of, you could tell he was like a little taken back. You know, just not an affectionate guy, man. But
no, he's a great guy, great dude. Every time he sees me, he's like, "What game are you going to?" Or stuff like that.
No, listen, get me wrong. I'm not. You know, he's amazing. Like, but I guess he felt because the way, you know, things ended with me and him. Like, I didn't have that love for him, but I learned a lot of life lessons from Coach Gantlin. Even, like, now, like, the way I teach defense, it was from him, you know? Like, he really, like, strategized on defense. And, you know, his principles, they're from him. Definitely from me. So, now I love Coach, but, you know, just I think he probably, like, when he seen me, was just, like, you know, thinking, like, why is he hugging me? Like, you know, he left the school because we kind of went back and forth. So I guess he felt like, you know, why is this guy like, you know, but, you know, I'm older. I understand what he was trying to do. And, you know, so it was no big, you know, no issue with me. But, I love Coach Young. Good guy, man. Really great guy. Great guy. A lot of history, too, man.
Mm. So how did that season go?
The 1 year I did play, I sat and I played, you know, going pretty well. I played a little bit here and there towards the end of the season. I started playing a whole lot more. You know, at that time, I'm like 6'8", but I'm a stick. I'm like, you know, like 190, 200, you know, so trying to, like, figure out, like, you know, what works for me against older guys. And, you know, it was an adjustment, but once I figured it out, I was a lot more effective. You know, same friends, you know, because you've been there. Mm-hmm. You know, those guys, they always get guys that have no business being in that conference. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it was a lot of talented guys there, you know, when I was on that team. And, you know, I had to fight against, you know, older guys, a lot of overseas guys, you know, we was getting at the time. You know, and it was older. It wasn't like, you know, like 21-year-old or, you know, 20-year-old juniors and seniors. They were like 22, 23, you know, a little bit old. And, you know, so it was challenging. And, you know, we had a good season. I want to say we probably lost in the second round that year. I can't remember who. I think Monmouth was really good at the time. They had a kid from D.C. that was really, really good. And we lost them in the second round.
Mm-hmm. So then you went off to Westchester?
I went to Westchester Community College. Played 1 year there with my really good friend Shane Gatson. We won the region. We lost, like, in the districts to, I want to say it was it Allegheny? I think it was, like, I can't think of the name of the school. They had two guys that went, like, well, one guy that went to West Virginia, another one went to Virginia Tech. It was small, but the guards were amazing. The guard play was amazing. I think it was Hagerstown. Hagerstown we lost to.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I had a good year there. I don't remember what I averaged or whatever. We played a lot of cupcakes that year. I can't lie to you, because just the junior college basketball in the Northeast is not the same as, like, Florida, Texas, Kansas, and, you know, in those games, you know, I couldn't get myself up for it, honestly, or I wouldn't even play a lot. But
you felt like you were kind of, like, bored with the competition.
Yeah, you know, unfortunately, you know, and so. You know, but when we played a bunch of marquee games. We went down to Florida. You know, we played in the Chipola tournament. We went out to Vegas. We played against Dixie State, which at the time was a junior college. They had, you know, Marcus Banks, who played in the NBA. Another kid named, I think, was Jamie Loretta. He ended up going, like, to LSU. You know, we played some pretty tough, and those, like, my best games. We played Quintel Woods in Missouri, who ended up, you know, going to the NBA from junior college. And those games I did really well because, you know, I love challenges. But, like, as far as, like, you know, we played Rockland Community College or BMCC, I was just like, there's no way I'm getting on the floor with these guys. Like, come on. You know what I mean? Like, but, you know, learning experiences, you know, you just got to play hard whenever, you know, whoever's on the floor. It just doesn't matter. But I at that time, me personally, I couldn't get up for those games. I just couldn't.
Mm. So, after that, you never played college ball again?
No. After that, I finished. I went to Wagner. I graduated from Westchester. I went to Wagner for a year.
Mm-hmm.
was a culture shock. I was playing for Coach Derek Wittenberg, great guy from D.C. Just, you know, again, from my background and my history and, you know, from me telling the story, you know, I didn't play a lot of high school basketball, really didn't, you know, a lot of structure in my life. You know, my dad passed when I was young. My mom, you know, was kind of like, you know, doing her own thing. I was raised by my aunt, my grandmother, my great-grandmother. You know, so I kind of, you know, came and went as I pleased. You know, and it kind of, you know, affected me a little bit when it came to basketball, like instruction. Like, I chose Wagner over a bunch of schools that were, like, you would say that, you know, bigger. UNC Charlotte, St. Louis. I think I had LaSalle at the time. A big thing for me was I wanted to stay close to home.
Right.
Great grandmother was getting sick. My aunt, you know, was by herself at the time. And I thought, you know, I'm in Staten Island, I can get back and forth, you know, whenever need be, and, you know, see my family. And, you know, that was never the case. Like, literally, like, you know, we have days off and have, you know, activities, or he'll make it to where, you know, every 8-12 hours he had to see us, even on days off. So I couldn't, like, really, you know, get back and forth to Queens how I wanted to. And, you know, I didn't like that, but I understand, you know, the structure. He was trying to teach a structure, you know, togetherness, and, you know, I kind of rebelled a bit. Talent-wise, man, I probably should have been the player of the year in the NEC that year. And at that time, I'm 6'9". I'm still, you know, still a stick. I'm like 210, you know, I can handle, can shoot, you know, can post. I mean, I could do it. I could do it all at this time. Now I'm 6'9". You know, I could play pretty much anywhere from, like, the 2 to the 5. And, you know, I didn't play. Didn't play a lot, you know. Me and him bumped heads a lot. It was a real, you know, ego thing between both of us. You know, like, could really help that team, and, you know, he wanted things done a certain way, and if I wasn't willing to comply with it, I was going to sit on the bench. And, you know, that's what kind of happened. I remember when I started out, you know, I wasn't starting because, you know, he was loyal to the guys that I guess he had brought in initially when he first got the job, which was cool. But I was still playing 20-something minutes. I was coming off the bench. I was averaging like 14, 15 points a game, like 8 rebounds. And then it's funny. I'll never forget it. We played against Brown. We lost. Mm-hmm. And we went on the film. You know, all guys know, you know, film don't lie, man. So we went over film, and he started breaking down film. And, you know, he just literally, you know, he was right. He was, you know, you don't play defense. And, you know, he made it rough for me after that. Like, you know, had to really, you know, sharpen up on rotations and timing and help side and that kind of stuff. And then, you know, I wasn't bad at it. I was just really focused on scoring. And he kind of used that to, you know, like, to kind of sit me down and you know, it was rough. I had braids at the time. He wanted me to cut my hair. I didn't want to cut my hair. You know, so I'm sitting on the bench because I didn't want to cut my hair. You know, when I finally cut my hair, the season was over, and, you know, it's too late now. You know, I ain't going to play you. It was, Wagner was an experience, you know, but again, I needed that. I learned a lot from it that year, you know, as far as, you know, pushing myself and really working hard and working on my game. So I didn't play, but I learned a lot from it as a person. I learned a lot about myself. You know, when I think I'm tired, I'm just getting started, you know, those kind of, you know, lessons, you know, structure, being on time for things, you know, being together with your team, and, you know, like, even as a coach now, like, you know, so, like, I learned a lot. You know, it didn't go well for me, you know, statistically wise, but I learned a lot from it.
How did you manage to play for two schools in the same conference?
Well, when I jumped to the JUCO, it allowed me to go back to the NEC, and it was funny because I think, like, there's, like, some kind of rule now that you can't do that, which is, you know, which is weird, but that's what, you know, allowed me to do it. I went to the JUCO for the year and I came back. But after that, I want to say honestly, I think it was some kind of rule implemented, like, you can't do that.
Okay. So then you decided to do the pro thing.
One more year. At this point, I was, you know, obviously I bounced around to a lot of schools. This is like that was my third school in 4 years. My last year, I finished in an NAIA school in New Orleans.
Okay.
Southern University, New Orleans. I played really well there. You know, the coach was a, you know, older guy, really, really cool dude. Gave me a lot of freedom. I was like, you know, somewhere like, I can't remember, maybe like 19, 20, 21 points, somewhere in that area of about like 9 rebounds, 2 blocks. I made NAIA All-American, I don't mention. School had its best year when I was there. We had a bunch of Division I guys there, you know, Touche Harvey from Houston, Courtney Trash went to Memphis and I think Utah, had a couple of guys from Brazil. But that was like the school's best year in basketball, 26-4. This was 2002, 2003. Out of there, I actually had a couple of workouts with NBA teams. I worked out with the Hornets. I worked out with Seattle Supersonics at the time. I had like 2 workouts. So I was kind of on the radar like once I finished.
Okay. So you didn't get drafted.
No.
But you did get to play for the Sixers. How long did you get to play for the Sixers?
Well, the thing was at that time, it was 2008. I played in the G League that year, and Jeff Rulin was on my coach. And when the season was over, he kind of told me that, you know, I was going to get signed. Couldn't tell anybody. And, you know, I came back home. I was bouncing back and forth from New York and Philly, working out with those guys, playing here, you know, like in the summertime, the West 4th, 145th, Hoops in the Sun, Kingdom, you know, whatever, you know, everything, you know, Rucker. And so I knew I was going to be with the Sixers like in May. I actually officially signed the contract because I couldn't sign any earlier than that. Mm-hmm. I officially signed like in October. I didn't get any preseason games. I was with them all the way up until right, you know, before the regular season started.
Oh, so you had kind of like a training camp deal.
Yeah. I mean, well, no, it was a real contract. It was, you know, a non-guaranteed, 1-year non-guaranteed contract, but they released me at, you know, at the end of preseason.
Mm. So I see you got to play with Elton Brand, Samuel Dallenberg,
yeah,
Andre Iguodala, Andre Miller, Theo Ratliff, Kareem Rush.
Yes, sir.
Will. That seemed like a pretty good squad.
Yeah, Royal Ivy. Listen, those guys were great. You know, Lou was really good to me. Iguodala was really good to me. Reggie Evans was like kind of like my vet. Royal Ivy, you know, from Queens. Royal was there. It's a good time, man. You know, unfortunately it didn't work out. And even when they, you know, brought me in to release me, like, you know, Coach Cheeks had told me, was like, listen, it was nothing you did, you know, it's a money thing, you know. At that time they just signed Elton and Andre to like max contracts. I think Elton got 80 and Andre got 81. And it was just like, you know, it's a financial thing. You know, you could keep up to 15 guys on the roster at that time. And Philly played with, I think, 13 guys that year.
Wow.
And they actually left 2 roster spots open that whole year. And Coach Cheeks got fired like around December, January sometime. But I had a great time. I learned a lot. And, you know, sad it didn't work out. But you know how it is. Got to be in the right place at the right time, you know, when it comes to NBA with a little bit of luck, you know? So, after the experience, I felt like, you know, I was an NBA guy for sure, and I could play in the NBA. I went back to the G League. I played in the G League after that.
So, basically, what was the best pro experience that you ever had outside of the Sixers?
I love the G League. I can't lie. You know, I wasn't one of those guys who was crazy about playing abroad. You know, it depends where you go. Like your first country is kind of like very imperative about, like, you know, I guess, like, well, a guy like me, I don't want to put that on everybody, but my first country in Europe was Poland, and it was terrible. I didn't like it at all. I was in a small city, Kozelek. Shout out to Chutney Gray. Chutney Gray had got me a job. I just didn't like it. You know, I was homesick. You know, it was new to me. You know, wake up at 8:30 in the morning. It was still dark outside. It was always, like, snowing or raining. And then also my playing style, like, you know, I'm 6'9", 6'10". I'm not like a banger. At that time, I think Europe was looking for bigs, guys who was going to come in and rebound, dunk, set screens, use all your fouls. And I wasn't that. You know, I played all over. I can handle the ball. I can post. I can, you know, shoot threes. You know, I played all over. So it wasn't, I guess, what they was looking for at the time. And after like a month, they released me. And then, and that's when I kind of came to, like, I had like a conversation with myself, like, you know, I didn't grow up, you know, dreaming of playing in Europe. You know, I want to play in the NBA. Like, so I'm not leaving, you know, the country until I get to the NBA. And, you know, I was hell bent on playing in the NBA. Like, I played in the CBA and, you know, G League, and, you know, until I got to my goal. So, you know, kind of like, you know, I didn't go back over. I played in DR. I played in Brazil as well. And, but after, like, that Poland experience, I was done. Like, I, in my mind, I was done. But I did go and play. I played in China after my little experience with the Sixers. I went to the G League. I played really well for a couple of months, and I got brought out of my contract, and I went to China. I finished the season in China.
Mm-hmm. So after you retired, you know, what made you want to get into training kids and coaching?
Well, you know, it's a great way to stay involved with the game. It started with literally when I was done, when I stopped playing in 2011. I was back in New York, and former AAU teammate of mine, JC Mathis, his brother, working at ISA. And, you know, he said, you know, he asked me, like, you know, do you want a job? And I was like, not really. I mean, once he kind of started explaining, like, the details and the specifics of the job, like, you know, you're working with kids, you'll be, like, you know, the basketball coach is only, like, 4 hours a day, you know. And I was like, damn, you know, that's not bad at all. You know what? Yeah, why not? So, you know, I was looking at first like it was just, like, free money. It was easy money. It was, the job was, like, $30 an hour for 4 hours. And, you know, all I have to do is go play basketball with kids, and I'm getting $30 an hour. Like, I'm not going to turn it down. So, you know, I started out, I was going, and that's where I kind of, like, you know, started with the mentoring kids, training, you know, coaching, like, really just being hands-on with the kids because, you know, it was good. It was a good match, and I just felt like after a while, you know, you're playing all these years, and, you know, you don't help the youth. Like, it's almost, like, selfish. So, you know, that's where it started for me. You know, I worked at, it was called Sports and Arts. And I was working at ISA with the kids. So that's how it started out.
So basically, like, who are some of the kids that you're training now?
Okay. You know, I don't want to say, like, you know, like, I'm one of those guys, like, I'm taking a whole bunch of clients. I'm very selective, and not like, you know, like in a nasty way, but, mm-hmm. You know, I like to see if a kid really wants to play basketball. Like, he has a desire to be a pro. You know, not one of these guys who, you know, wants to train because they know, you know, I helped Jalen LeCue, you know, achieve what he achieved. Or because, you know, a guy like Eric Gaines, or, you know, I know, you know, Davon Smith. You know what I mean? Like, I don't want those guys. I don't want the guys that want to come because they, you know, I know, you know, a couple of popular guys, or I help them or assist them, you know, reaching their goals. I want, you know, guys that really, you know, want to be pros one day. So, like, I take it serious, and I want my guys to take it serious. So, you know, I do one-on-ones only. I probably lose a lot of money because I only do one-on-ones. But, you know, it's not about the money with me. It's really about seeing kids, you know, take steps in their games and develop. Currently, right now, I train a couple young kids, Dwayne Pierce, eighth grader, from out in Long Island. I get with Nasir Cunningham, eighth grade from Jersey, about 6'6", 6'7". I was going to Gil St. Bernard, a really, really good kid. Who else am I working with now? Jaleel Pathia from Christ the King. You know, I work out a lot with Sterling Jones. He's like my guy. Training Kyra Lewis. Trying to think who else currently. You know, it's off the top of my head. That's about it right now, you know? That's about it. I'm sure I'm missing some other guys, you know, but those are, like, some of the guys that I think people would know.
Talk about, you know, the maturation of Jalen LeCue's game. when you were working, like you, I know you were coached him at Southern Stampede. Talk about, you know, where he was then to what he's doing now. Like, how proud of him are you?
I'm extremely proud of him, man. You know, like, Rook is, like, you know, really good kid. You know, to watch that happen for him was like almost, it was like being in a movie. It was like almost like, you know, unheard of. You know, guy was probably the third, fourth best guy on that team, on that Monsignor Scanlon team at the time. Literally, you know, he kind of had an idea. He knew what he wanted to do. He just wanted to get out the city and, like, reestablish himself or have a fresh start. And, you know, Rook, you know, like, he wanted to reclass and go down south somewhere. And, you know, I found the school. I thought it was really a good fit for him. And even with us, when EYBL circuit held with the Stampede, you know, I knew that, you know, I didn't know how good we were going to be, but I knew he had every opportunity with us to, you know, write his own ticket and do, you know, what he did, which is, you know, turn himself into, like, literally an unranked kid into a top 10, you know, prospect, you know. So I'm very proud of him. You know, I put a lot of work in with him, you know, as far as just, you know, helping him, you know, with stuff behind the scenes, you know, getting in the gym with him and working on his game as far as, you know, trying to, like, you know, construct an identity for him as a basketball player, which I feel is huge. Like, you know, you're training kids or, you know, you got really a good relationship with a kid. You kind of got to, like, almost – it's dangerous, but, you know, you almost got to, like, say, listen, this is why I envision you as. This is what I think your end game is. Like, you know, the first two sessions of EYBL, like, we had Rook playing off the ball. And literally after I took him to Elite 100 in St. Louis, he played point. And I'm like, holy shit, like, he can play the point, you know. And it's a whole lot more appealing. 6'4", point guard can jump, you know, jump out the gym, you know. And that's where it really started coming together for him. Like, once we moved him over to the point and, you know, really started working with him on, you know, making reads and, you know, playing with the ball in his hands and, you know, that kind of stuff. And, you know, just getting him, like, you know, like, to really get to those elbows, you know, his spots, you know, and take mid-range shots. And, you know, and you only have to make the three-point shot that's wide open. Like, you don't have to be this, you know, this knockdown three. Everybody's not going to be, you know, shooters or three-point specialists. And, you know, like, just drilling those kind of things in his head and just working with him on, you know, his game, you know, that's what it was for me, you know. And just, you know, also, like, protecting him from, you know, the other BS that's out there and all that other stuff. So, you know, very proud of him, man. You know, I'm happy, you know, he got to his end goal. You know, wish him all the best. Want him to stay safe and, you know, keep good people around him. And, you know, that's it. And, you know, he's grown now, you know, so he's got to, you know, he's got to kind of figure out for his own now, you know.
You always talk about Kira Lewis, you know. What can you tell us about him?
Kyra is an amazing kid. Comes from a great family. You know, me and his mom is really close. You know, I came across Kyra when I was coaching with the Georgia Stars after, you know, the Stampede lost the EYBL deal. You know, I transitioned over to the Georgia Stars. And that year, you know, I recruited Kyra. I didn't recruit Kyra, I'm sorry. You know, Kyra was being recruited by somebody else. But I brought over Trendon Wadfoot, Koripovich, I hope I didn't kill his name. And also,
Balsa Koprivica from Florida State.
Yes, I know I killed his name. I brought those guys over. Trey McGowns as well as one of my closer guys. You know, Kyra, like, I seen it from day one. He had an NBA attribute that, you know, from young, speed. And, you know, Kyra can shoot the ball. He can handle the ball. At that time, really didn't care that much to play point. Just wanted to play, you know. Wasn't really a big thing for him if he had the ball. He didn't have the ball, but great, amazing kid. Mom keeps him balanced, very humble. You know, really a good kid. You know, mature beyond his years. You know, close. You know, small circle. You know, I'm a huge fan of his. Huge fan of his, as you know. He's gonna be in the draft this year. You know, I work with him a lot whenever I get the chance. You know, I just moved back from Atlanta up to New York. But, you know, when I was in Atlanta, literally any chance I could get, you know, I'm dropping over and I'm going to school. I'm going, you know, to Huntsville, Alabama, and I'm working with them.
Now, talk about back to you. Talk about playing street ball. What was the one street ball tournament or summer league that you enjoyed playing in?
Well, for me, it was tough. I want to say these three places were a tie. Okay. I don't want to give it all to one place. I love playing at West Ball. I love playing in Pro City. And I also love playing at Hoops in the Sun. Yeah. So those are my three favorite places. I mean, like, it was hot as shit at Hoops in the Sun, but, you know, Joe and Randy are really good dudes, man, and, like, they really made me feel welcome. And that's actually where I got the nickname from. The Undertaker was from the Cruz Brothers, you know? So love Orchard Beach, love Pro City, of course, you know, because of what it is, you know, and everybody was there, and, you know, you play well at Pro City, you know, everybody was running around the city talking about you, like, yo, see Wood, Undertaker, he had 20, you know. So that was always a big thing for me. And West Fourth, I just loved it. I don't know why. It was a small court, but I always have really, really big games at West Fourth, like really big games, you know, 30, 27, 40. I really had really big games at West Fourth. I just loved the atmosphere down there.
Now, this year, you coached at Christ the King. Talk about that experience.
Again, you know, I moved up here to coach at that new Patrick School situation that was supposed to be in South Jersey. Mm-hmm. And fell through, you know, I guess the guys that were investing in it, you know, they needed some time or whatever. But, you know, I think a positive that came from out of it was Christ the King. Literally, you know, I met with Coach Arbatello. And, you know, we sat down, you know, kind of came up with a game plan. And it wasn't about, you know, Corey, I know you can get me, you know, some great kids of talent. I just want great people around me. I want good people around me. And, you know, that was huge because literally, like, you know, it wasn't about, you know, who I can bring in and that kind of stuff. And I don't think he knew of what I can do as far as the player development side. But it was a great match. Like, I love Coach Hobbs. I love, you know, being that Crazy King, you know, being a Queens guy. You know, everybody, I don't care who you are, any kid, you're from Queens, you grew up dreaming about, you know, putting on that Crazy King uniform. And, you know, I didn't do it, but, like, this kind of almost, like, you know, makes me feel like I'm a part of, like, you know, the family over there and everything that, you know, those guys do. You know, I love it, you know. Crazy King is just, you know, it's Crazy King. You know, no matter how you put it and slice it, you know, it's a, you know, you start naming programs in the city, not in the country. You know, you're going to name Christ the King.
Mm-hmm. So, final question. What's next in the future for Corey Underwood?
Well, you know, I'm here. I'm here, man. A big thing for me now is I want to make a difference where I'm from. You know, New York City, Queens. I want to help change and, you know, do what I did for, like, you know, guys like, you know, Q and, you know, Kyra, Trey McGowan, you know, these guys, you know, that I'm affiliated with. I want to do that for, you know, for guys here in the city. I want to kind of restore, you know, the Catholic League, the PSAL, you know, just kids, period. I want to help here. You know, I like, it's like what Penny Hardaway said when he was with those guys on All the Smoke, the podcast. Like, you know, it's different when somebody you know you can actually touch and talk and rap and talk with who made it, you know, and is there with you, like, you know, on a day-to-day basis, like, you know, getting down and dirty with you who made it. It kind of gives you, you know, more of a feeling like I can do it too. And, like, I was lucky enough to be around a lot of guys, like, well, mainly Speedy. Speedy, you know, I seen Speedy, like, his whole story. So to watch a guy that, you know, is from my neighborhood make it, become an NBA player, it gave me more of a feeling, like more of a sense of that I could do it too. Like, shit, Speedy did it. Why can't I do it? Like, he's from where I'm from, you know, like, I could do it too. So that's kind of my goal right now. You know, I think, you know, maybe in a few years, you know, I might venture off or do something else, whether it's, you know, hopefully, you know, work for an NBA team in the front office in some capacity. But right now, I want to, you know, help the youth of the city, give back to the city, help the city get back on top, and you know, and influence guys here, and you know, teach and do some, you know, play development and coach. That's you know, right now.
Well, thank you for your incredible story, Corey, and I wish you and PDI the best of luck and continue to help out these kids. You know, because they need, we in New York City, we need some positive influences like you that have been through hardship and seen some things, and just keep up the great work.
Dave, thanks, man. You too, man. You know, I'm always proud of you when I see you doing this kind of stuff, man. Mm-hmm. I remember it was funny when you posted the clip from the Christ the King step in that game. I actually recorded the same thing, man, because I was going, send it to you, but you had beat me to it. Like, but like, you know, I'm always proud of me. Like, you know, for years I've been telling you, man, like when you first started out with doing this, the stories and, you know, you added, you know, like branches to your tree. I love it all, man. So, you know, anything, you know, with you, I'm always, you know, here to support and help get it out there and let people know, you know, what the great stuff you're doing, man.
Indeed. Well, everybody, this is episode 7. Check us out on YouTube and Instagram TV and all our social media pages. Stay safe during this pandemic. Do the right thing. And that's all for today. Peace.
Peace, Dave.